Classical music is absolutely timeless. It's like the Beatles. They will be timeless as well. It's like Elvis Presley. Certain things in life don't have a time expiration. The emotions did not change in humankind over the last 200 years, 300, 400, maybe even 1,000 years. We're still working with the same basic construction of our brain. I opened the album Iconic with an arrangement by Jascha Heifetz. The story behind this piece is Jascha Heifetz was in Mexico City and he had a concert that night. And he was sitting in a cafe and heard this endearing melody, Estrelita, sung by somebody in the cafe. And he fell in love with this tune and decided to arrange it for piano and violin. And we've taken this great tune and orchestrated it together with the violin. Deutsche Grammophon is without a doubt the most prestige classical label since 100 and some years. All the greats, all the icons recorded for this label. I myself did sign, I think, as the youngest artist ever with Deutsche Grammophon when I was 13 years old. Looking back, that is absolutely ludicrous. And still also amazing to have had the chance to record that early with great conductors, with great studios, with great directors, etc. But of course, it's also a huge responsibility if you look at the roster of artists who recorded with them. It's just the top of the top. So of course, going back to Deutsche Grammophon and recording, it's a responsibility and of course a dream come true. It has been with 13, it still is. The Sicilienne is attributed to Maria Theresia de Paradis, a piano player. And it is almost a Baroque like piece, originally written for piano. One of those pieces which disappeared in the repertoire of great violinists. And I remember listening to a recording as a kid by Arthur Gourmillon, which really impressed me. So when I had the chance to record this concept, this one popped in my mind immediately. Very, very happy that I got to record the Shostakovich with my former teacher and one of my heroes, Itzhak Perlman. Of course, being a student of Mr. Perlman, it was very important for me to have the right sound. He always was very particular about sound projection, about the colors of vibrato, the bow, the lilt. And so I did not want to disappoint him, so I took specially care that he would like my interpretation. Another collaboration we did for this album is the song La Fille aux cheveux de lin by Claude Debussy. Beautiful, impressionistic work. And I got to collaborate with Kokomi on this piece. I'm very happy that she was part of my recording. I have two beautiful instruments. I'm really, really lucky in my life. I have a wonderful Stradivari from the Golden Period from 1716. But for this recording, I used for the first time a Guarneri del Gesù from 1734. It's called the Prince Doria, which was lent to me by the Cremona Instrument Museum and the Friends of Stradivari Society. And for me, even the fact that most of the great violinists, starting with Niccolo Paganini, then over Isaiah, Isaac Stern, Menuhin, Yasha Heifetz, they all played Guarneri del Gesù violins. So especially when you look at the iconic violinists, they tend to use Guarneri del Gesù more often than Stradivari. So maybe for this record, it was the perfect instrument. Well, I have four wonderful features and I'm very proud to have them included on this album. First and foremost, the wonderful violinist Itzhak Perlman, who is an icon and my teacher for many years at the Juilliard School in New York when I was studying with him. And I did write him an email if he would be happy to do one piece with me, and I suggested an arrangement me and Frank van der Heijden did from the Shostakovich duos. And I was delighted that he agreed to do it. So thank you very, very much again. The second collaboration I was really looking forward to was getting a wonderful tenor, which I've been working with for the last couple of years, already a few times in the past. I even had the honor to write a song for him, which is called Ma Dove Sei. But for this classical album, I really wanted to have Andrea Bocelli in a new duet version for Ave Maria from Franz Schubert. So I'm super excited that he agreed to do this. Thank you, Andrea. The third wonderful musician comes more from the jazz direction. It's Till Brönner, wonderful, great instrumentalist, virtuoso. And there is a very famous piece for violin. It's called Hora Staccato. It's based on a Romanian folk tune. And it's also quite famous in the trumpet repertoire as a classical piece. But the original feel, the folk song feel, is actually closer to jazz than classical trumpet playing. That's why I immediately thought that Till would find the right approach to join me with the violin. And he did amazingly, beautifully done. And the last collaboration we did was for a piece by Claude Debussy, one of the most famous ones, The Girl with the Flaxen Hair. And I asked Kukomi, who is a Japanese flutist. I recently worked with her for her own album, and so the connection was already there, and she was kind enough to join in. When you pick up the phone or when you write an email, the first thing which comes to mind is hopefully they're not going to write back, no, I don't know if I can bear it. So, of course, even if you're successful, you're still kind of self-doubting what you've been doing in life. That's a normal feel you have as an artist. So it takes a little bit of backbone to sit in your room or when you're on the road and type this message, because you really don't want to get a no. So I'm very, very happy that the people I contacted were kind enough to say, yes, we'd love to work with you. That means the world to me. Well, we're changing pace again for number 21 on the record. It's by Camille Saint-Saëns. Yet another piece. It's the Danse Macabre, which starts with a tritone. It's very adventurous. It's very rhythmical. The second piece where we used percussion elements. I'm very excited to play this live. Very virtuosic, very fun. And it's quite a piece. So I'm looking forward to playing this. Better practice well so you play better tomorrow. For me, it's really necessary to always believe that you can improve. If you stop believing that you can improve, what is the sense of practicing? Never left classical music. It's a strange question for me because every morning I wake up and play classical music. Every afternoon I play classical music. My whole education is based on classical music. So for me, there is no back and forth. Even if I play a tour with crossover music, I wake up and play classical. And of course, I play some of the pieces slowly through. But every day starts the same. Scales, etudes, solo Bach, repertoire, which I'm learning, new repertoire, old repertoire, which I'm going through again. And then maybe at some point in the afternoon, I go through things which I have to play on stage. As I said, no back and forth. One of the most famous instrumental tracks in the repertoire of violin is without a doubt the Four Seasons by Antonio Vivaldi. Everybody knows this piece. A lot of people will associate probably the last movement of the summer, but another piece people will definitely recognize is the beautiful second movement from the winter, and it's part of this programmatic music where composers tried to make nature sound. In this case, if you listen to the pizzicato of the string sections, it's supposed to imitate the snowflakes falling down. Very famous opera composer, Gluck, wrote many beautiful operas, including Orpheus and Eurydice. And out of this very tragic opera, we took the gorgeous melody and rearranged it for orchestra and violin.